Everybody feeling good this morning? Man, I hope that you've come with an expectancy today. I hope you've come expectant just to hear from the Holy Spirit. I know I have this morning. I have a message that's been burning on my heart really all week, and man, I'm excited just to get it out. If we haven't met before, my name's Adam, and it's my privilege to welcome you here. Man, if you would, at the end of service, we haven't met before, come forward and just say hello to me. I'd love to meet you. We are in a series entitled Supernatural Building. Supernatural Building. And what we're doing is we're looking at how Nehemiah built the walls of Jerusalem in just 52 days. Jerusalem tried to build the walls in over 70 years, but Nehemiah was able to do it in just 52 days. How many of you know that whenever God's doing something, he's a part of it, it's supernatural? Yeah? And he did it supernaturally through the power of the Holy Spirit, and he was able to complete the walls in 52 days. We're going to be in Nehemiah chapter 8 this morning, but before we turn there and we read, just let me catch you up on where we're at in the story here in the book of Nehemiah. So in chapter 1, Nehemiah hears of the walls being broken down and being destroyed by the Assyrians and Babylonians, and God gives him a heart, and what happens is his heart breaks for what breaks the heart of God. We pray that very powerful prayer, God, break my heart for what breaks yours in week one. Then he goes to the king, the Assyrian king. He says, hey, I've got to go rebuild the walls. And the Assyrian king gave him favor. He was a cupbearer. He gave him favor to go rebuild the walls. And not only did he give him favor, but he told him he could go, but he gave him an army to go with it and resources to build the walls. He shows up on the scene in Jerusalem to assess what that was going on and what was happening. He assesses the walls at nighttime so his enemies could not see what was happening and going on and his plan to rebuild the walls. He approaches the leaders of that day and says, hey, it's time to build. And the leaders of that day said, yes, let's arise and build. But everything wasn't easy. Actually, the Israel, at different moments in time, they had a sword in one hand and a hammer in the other, trying to build these walls. They were fighting opposition. Pastor Eric, our founding pastor, talked about opposition last week, that we are in spiritual warfare. How many of you know that? Man, we are in spiritual warfare in the days that we live. And we have to, as we're building, we also have to be aware of what's going on around us. Finally, they rebuild the walls and it's completed. And we see that happening at the end of chapter 6, the beginning of chapter 7. And we find ourselves in chapter 8 this morning. And what they're doing is they're celebrating the completion of the walls. Let's read this text together. It says this, and all the people gathered as one man into the square before the water gate. It's interesting that the water gate was the one gate that was not destroyed during the siege. Water stands for the Holy Spirit. It stands for cleansing in John chapter 4. So you kind of see the parallel. Don't you love the word of God and how that kind of works altogether? You'll see the importance of this here in a moment. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law that the Lord had commanded Israel. So the people, they hungered for the word of God. Verse 2. So Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the assembly, both men and women, and all who could understand what they heard on the first day of the seventh month. And he read from it facing the square before the water gate from early morning until midday. So you can see he's reading the Torah, he's reading the Mosaic Law, the first five books of the Old Testament for about 4 to 6 hours at this time. Reading on, in the presence of the men and women and those who could understand, the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. So they were attentive, they were hanging on to every single word that Ezra was speaking, whatever Ezra was reading. Ezra the scribe stood on a wooden platform and they had made the purpose, and behind him stood, I'm going to give you, there's 13 names here. I'm not going to read them all because they're hard to read, but they stood on the left and on the right. There's 13 of them. Just remember 13. Verse 5, and Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people as he opened it, and all the people stood. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen, amen, lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces also to the ground. Also, so here we read another. There's 13 Levitical priests here to help explain the word of God. 13. So 13 is a number that Satan's tried to hijack. Friday the 13th, right? But 13th actually in Hebrew is a sign of strength. So you have 13 men standing on Ezra's left and right, and then 13 men explaining the word of God to the people. Verse 8. They read from the book, from the law of God clearly, and they gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor of Ezra, the priests and scribe and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, "This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep," for all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. The word of God is powerful, isn't it? Then he said to them, "Go your way, eat the fat and drink the sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready, for this day is holy to our Lord God. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." We're going to be talking about this next week. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Verse 11, so the Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be quiet, for this day is holy. Do not be grieved." And all the people went their way to eat and drink and to send portions and to make great rejoicing, because they had understood the words that were declared to them. So get this picture, church. The crowds of people gathered together at the water gate. This is a place of commerce. They'd actually didn't gather at the temple. The temple was already rebuilt. They gathered outside the temple at the water gate. And they're listening to Ezra read the word of God. And as he's reading the word of God, because the word of God is so powerful, they receive the word of God, and people literally begin to weep and they begin to turn from their sin. You can look at how they repent in chapter 9. But the people turn from their idols, they turn from their sin, and they weep over what they have done. There is revival happening right here as we read this story. There is revival happening in these group of people. As they hear the word of God, it pierces their hearts and it draws them to the Lord, and they turn from their sin and they turn towards God. What I want to talk about this morning is this: finding personal revival. Finding personal revival. How many of you know we all want corporate revival? We all want a move of God. We want to all see a group of people gathering together where God is moving and there's healings happening and there's an outpouring of the manifest presence of God. But it's not going to happen without some of us having personal revival. Personal revival. Revival starts with you, church, as an individual. Can you say revival starts with me? Come on, one more time. That's beautiful. Revival starts with me. It starts with me, church. It starts with you. Revival starts with me. So I've entitled my message this morning, Finding Personal Revival. This is part one. We're going to talk about this again next week a little bit. If you like my notes, you can text notes to the number on the screen, and what's in front of me is in front of you. You can also go to your app store and search Journey Church Jacksonville, download the Journey app, and you can find the message notes in the app. Let's pray. Let's just invite the Holy Spirit to speak to us this morning. Lord, we understand and we realize that God, revival starts with us. Lord, as we open up your Logos word, your written word, I pray this morning that we become rhema to us, O God. Just as the people in that day, as they read the word of God and Ezra began to declare it, Lord Jesus, Lord, I pray that, God, we would receive your word, God, just as those people received it on that day, God. That, Lord, we would turn from our sin, turn from our wicked ways, and we would set our attention on you, Jesus. Lord, you are calling a people to live set apart in holy lives, God. And so, Lord, we pray that, God, we would be those people. I pray that, Lord, this is a challenging word today, God. I pray that we'd receive it and we'd walk it out. We wouldn't just be hearers of the word, God, but, Lord, we would be doers, Father. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We invite you here to speak, God. No one came here today to hear from me or to sing a song, but Holy Spirit, we all came here to hear from you. So we say to you this morning, God, speak to your people, God. Speak to me this morning, Jesus, for your servants are listening. We thank you, Father. We love you. We bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. About 20 years ago, 19 years ago or so, my wife and I, we went on our first date. And it took me about 6 months to actually ask her out. I mean, my friends, they made it super awkward and super weird, so it took some time to finally ask her out. And we get the date scheduled. It's early December, and it's a magical time because it's December time, and we're living in Charleston, South Carolina at the time. And if you've ever been to Charleston downtown, it's beautiful. Like, it's next level beautiful. At the time, I was interning for my church, and I was making a very mere $200 a week. And so I think I spent my entire week's salary on that one date because I wanted to impress her. I wanted her to know, man, I really like you a whole lot, kind of thing. I think I changed my shirt that day about 5 different times, and I actually ironed my shirt as well. As a young 20-year-old, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was ready. I was dressed to impress. I was ready to go. I wanted to put my best foot forward. But how many know that after 18 years of marriage, is it 18 years? 16? 16, 18? How many years? 16. I thought so. I knew that. I knew that. I'm in the doghouse. I was doing well until this point, wasn't I? I was doing okay until this point. After 16 years of marriage, she knows my bad, my good, and my ugly, right? She knows me in and out. She knows the good, the bad, and the ugly about me. Wow. She knows it. Here's the thing. We feel like sometimes we've got to do the same thing when we come before the Lord. We're trying to impress God. The Lord doesn't need to be impressed by us and what we can do and who we are. We don't need to impress him. I got the girl. I impressed Laura. It worked out. But now she knows the good, the bad, and the ugly. But we can be real. But how many know that with our relationship now, the realness of who we are is so much sweeter than trying to put on a front and trying to dress to the nine, right? God wants us to be real. Pastor Corey hit the nail on the head this morning as he was doing the transition. He wants us to come before him and give him the real, the raw, all of who we are. Bring our cares, bring our burdens, bring our worries before him and lay it at his feet. I think this was why David was a man after God's own heart. You can read throughout Psalms where he's coming, he's bringing God his frustration. Lord, why are my enemies coming against me? Lord, it feels like you're so far from me right now. Lord, what is going on? Where are you at? Why do you feel so far? But yet at the same time, he also expressed to the Lord, Lord, I love you so much. Lord, you are, as the deer pants for the water, so my soul pants after you. He still was real and raw with where he was at with the Lord in the midst of his struggles, in his difficulties, and his trials. Nehemiah, in his day, there was difficulties with the people of Israel. You can read in chapter 5 where there was a famine. You can read how the people in government were oppressing the people and taking away and putting too much taxes on them. They were experiencing a lot of difficulty. The wall at the time was not built yet. But yet, through that, God used that to bring revival to them, to bring revival to their situation. God used difficulty to birth personal repentance and revival in their life. Wouldn't you say, we talked about this a little bit last week, that we are in serious times as well? You know, there's different seasons of life, and there's seasons that are good, but there's also seasons that are serious times. And it doesn't feel like we're in a season of where it's a walk in the park, and we talked about this last week, but I believe the Lord is calling us as a church to step up and to be the warriors that God has called us to walk in and to be. And here's the thing about being a warrior. It takes a little more self-discipline and turning from our sin in order to have the authority through the God that's within us. I'll explain this a little bit more, but I think that revival looks like completely different, I think, than sometimes what we think that it looks like. I think some of us think that we can just show up here on a Sunday and then we're going to experience the power of the presence of God, which we can and we do, but not to the level and degree maybe that we have the ability to do it, because then when we leave here, what ends up happening is we turn back to our sin. We turn back to whatever makes us feel good and our comfortability. I think revival doesn't look like a goosebump or a feeling. Look, revival, it looks like us personally coming before the Lord and repenting and turning from our sin, turning from what makes us feel comfortable. Some of us have gotten so comfortable with our sin, and it's a part of who we are. And God is saying, give that up, walk away from it, and just turn towards me, amen? Nehemiah chapter 9, it says this in verse 2, and the Israelites separated themselves from all foreigners. Why? It's not because God didn't love foreigners or anything like that, but it's because the foreigners had false gods and had idols, and so they had to separate themselves from the idols. That's what it's talking about. They're separating themselves from false worship. And they stood and confessed their sins and their iniquities of their fathers. Let's look at Psalm 24 this morning. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who may stand in the holy place? That's personal revival right there. Going to the hill of the Lord, standing in the holy place, that's personal revival. Who is the person that can do that? Verse 4, he who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully. Verse 5, he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek his face. I want to give you three things this morning. Three things. Three ways you begin personal revival. Say, revival starts with me. Come one more time. We already said it. Revival starts with me. So three ways. Revival starts with you. Finding personal revival begins by turning from your idols. Finding personal revival begins by us, myself included, turning from our idols. Exodus 34:14. For you shall worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Hebrews 12:29. For our God is a consuming fire. What does God being a consuming fire, what does that mean? Let's break it down. Consuming means this, to use up, to destroy or annihilate, or to absorb the attention of someone or something. And in scripture, fire means this. Fire in this context, fire is used here as a form of judgment, purification, or refining. So when the Bible says he's a consuming fire, it means this. It means God will utterly destroy anything in your life that is unholy. God wants to utterly destroy anything in your life that is unholy. He can't be around a person with an idolatrous heart. This feels a little uncomfortable, doesn't it? He can't be around a person with an idolatrous heart. Deuteronomy 4:24, for the Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. You see, human jealousy is tainted by our sin and turns to anger. But God is without sin, right? And God is jealous for us. His jealousy is because of our idolatrous heart, because he doesn't want to share us with anyone else. Why? Because he loves you so much, he just wants to be with you personally. And he's not a God who wants to share you with anybody or anything else in your life. He is a jealous God. That's why he's a consuming fire. He wants to burn up everything that is in the way of having a deep relationship with you. I'm not talking about this morning about being a son and daughter of God. His grace is sufficient. There is nothing you could do to lose your salvation, I believe. Like, you are a son and daughter of God. What I'm talking about is going to the next level in your relationship with the Lord. You understand what I'm saying? Let me do this morning. I want to give you 7 idols in this modern era in our life. 7 idols. Here's number 1. Identity has become an idol in our lives. Our identity has become an idol in our life. We have largely abandoned who we are in Christ and place our identity in how we look on social media, a position at work, and our abilities, skills, our achievements that we are after. This is tricky, y'all. It's subtle how this can kind of take a hold as an idol in our life. Many of us have placed more value on who we are instead of whose we are. It's become an idol. The second idol I want to give you is money, material things in our life. Money, material things have become an idol. You don't have to have money, though, in order for money to be an idol. It's not about what you have, it's about what you long for. It's about where your heart is. Many people who are poor can have the mammon spirit operating in their life. They can have an idol of money in their life. Many people who have been blessed beyond measure, they don't struggle with this spirit. They don't struggle with money being an idol in their life because they will freely give it away and share it with other people. You see, it's a heart position. Hear me on this. Money is not bad. Money is a tool. And like any tool, you have to use it correctly and wisely. If it's not used correctly and wisely, it can damage your life. Money is not the problem. It's the view of money that is the problem. Money is not the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. It's when you love it. It's what you think about. It's putting its place ahead of God. That is an idol in our life. Can be an idol in our life. The third idol in this modern day era is our physical appearance. You can look anywhere and there's advertisements everywhere that are trying to get you to buy something because it makes you look younger, makes you look better, whatever it might be, right? Now let me make it very clear, like there's nothing wrong with taking care of yourself. We should take care of ourselves. We need to be healthy in spirit, soul, and body. But when we think about how we look more than God, that is an idol in our life. You know if it's an idol right now, if it's in your life. You know if you're struggling with this right now. I believe the Holy Spirit's speaking to you. The next idol in our life is sex. Sex might be the only thing we think about more than money. For many of us in this room, it's everywhere in our culture. We have taken a gift from God and made it into the God of our lives. And for many, their lives are controlled by sex. The church has some blame in this. Rather than portraying sex as a good gift from God in recent history, they have heaped it with guilt and with shame. But sex is beautiful within the context of marriage. It is a gift from God. But outside of marriage, it will destroy your relationships and destroy your life and your family. If you partake in this outside of marriage, it can wreck your life. You know, I'm not saying this in any kind of bragging way, but Laura and I, we saved ourselves for one another when we got married. I'm just saying that because it is possible today, young person, to save yourself for your spouse. You can do it. You can do it. Don't allow the idolatry of sex to be an idol in your life. The fifth idol in this modern era is this: comfort. Comfort has become an idol in America. There's an endless list of products promising to simplify and add comfort to your life. Tasks that used to take all day can be done in minutes. Many menial tasks now are automated. While that's a good thing, our pursuit in life should not be after comfort alone. Jesus promises his followers that in this life, there will be tribulation, church. There will be trials. And what happens is when comfort becomes an idol in our life, when the Lord tells us to do something that is halfway uncomfortable, we reject it because it's not comfortable anymore. We won't step out of our comfort zone. That's how you know that the idol of comfort has taken place in your life above God. Comfort is an idol. The next idol in this modern day era is phones, is technology, it's this thing right here. Hasn't it gotten so out of hand that if we're sitting at a table with our family that one of us inevitably is going to pick up our phone and have to look at it? Like, if you don't believe me, just go and open up your settings on your phone and look at your screen time. Like, it is appalling how much we look at our phones and we pick it up. There's a stat that I read that in 2021, that the average person spent 4.8 hours a day on their phone. That's one third of our waking life during a day. I mean, does that compute with how often people are looking at their phones, how much we're looking at it? 4.8 hours a day. If technology, if our phones are not an idol in our life, I don't know what is, right? I want to challenge you to do something. This next week, whatever day is your Sabbath, whatever day is your day of rest, take that day, take your phone, put it in a drawer for 8 hours. I promise you, everything is going to be okay when you do that. Just put it away someplace. You know, I went on a trip with my parents back a couple years ago, and I decided to leave my phone at home the entire trip for an entire week. It was one of the most freeing weeks of my entire life in the past 5 years, I'd say, because I just got away from this thing completely. Every once in a while, I'd check Laura's phone on some things, but you know what I'm saying. The next date you go on with your spouse, leave your phone at home. Just connect with your spouse. Just take 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever it is, and get away from it. Watch how much better your communication on that date is going to be. Don't worry about your kids. I mean, before we had phones, the kids were fine. Like, they're going to be okay. Leave it at home and just connect your spouse. I challenge you to do that. The next idol in our life, influence, fame. It can be an idol. With social media nowadays, people have the opportunity at any single point to feel like a video could go viral and all of a sudden they could be famous. You know, before, people struggled with the idol of just our identity, which we talked about number one, but this present day modern era, younger people are now struggling with the idol of just being famous because at any point they could be famous from a viral video. I mean, you have people on YouTube who are literally, they're playing Minecraft and they have millions of followers just playing Minecraft and people are watching that stuff and they get millions of dollars. How could it not be alluring to do that, right? It's an idol to want to be known. To want to be famous is an idol in this present day, modern world. There could be other idols in your life. That's just a few. But Deuteronomy 32, 16 says this. They provoked him to jealousy with foreign gods. With abominations, they provoked him to anger. Listen to this. Idolatrous activity will lead to a confrontation with God. For the people of God, idolatrous activity will lead to a confrontation with God. Why? Because God is jealous for us and will allow, he won't cause, but he will allow trials in our life to get our affection because he wants our attention. Abiding in Christ in obedience is an easier path to take, right? This leads to my second point this morning. The first, you begin personal revival by turning from your idols. The second way, number two, finding personal revival begins by cleansing your hands of sin. By cleansing your hands of sin. If you're bound in sin today, turn from sin. You are an overcomer. You can overcome the sin in your life, church. Listen to this, James 4:7, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Here's the point. The first thing that you do is what do? You submit to God. When you submit to God, then what happens? You're able to resist the devil. But if you don't submit to God, you can't resist the devil. And then what happens is he doesn't flee from you. Actually, what happens is the enemy will hound you. But if you start here with complete and total submission to God and humbling yourself before the Lord, you can overcome the sin that is binding you in your life. You are an overcomer. All it takes is walking humility and completely saying, Lord, I am yours and I submit to you. And what ends up happening is because if you don't submit to God, is you're still a child of God. Nothing is going to separate you from the love of God. You're still a child of God. But listen, because the enemy is the accuser of the brethren, your sin is putting a wedge in your relationship with the Lord. It's putting something between you and God. Just like a relationship that you might have. If Caleb and Ruth did something awful and walked away from me and didn't want anything to do with me any longer, they're still my son and daughter. I still love them, but there is something there in our relationship that is not going to ever happen in the name of Jesus. I'd bind it right. I didn't even think of that point before I started putting it out of my mouth. But if they did that, nothing's going to separate us from that relationship. But when sin separates you from God, I'm not talking about salvation issue right here. I'm talking about the deep friendship that you can potentially have with the Lord. Sin separates. But let me give you something encouraging this morning. Hebrews 12:1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Throw off everything that hinders you in your walk with the Lord. Throw it off. Get rid of it. Choose and make the choice to turn towards God by submitting to him first, because you can't do it out of willpower, and run the race that God has put it before you, because you have a purpose. God has a plan on your life, and it is time for us to rise up as warriors and walk in that plan and not let idolatry and not let our sin hold us back anymore, but say, Lord, my life is yours, and Lord, I will follow you, Jesus. And Lord, I pray and I declare over this house that we will be haters of our sin. May we hate our sin. May it not taste good at all. May it be so, may we feel filthy from it, yeah? And may holiness and righteousness be what is in our hearts and our one and only desire as we follow the Lord. The third thing I want to give you this morning is this. Finding personal revival begins by having a pure heart. It begins by having a pure heart. John 4:24, but a time is coming, is already here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit, from the heart, the inner self, and in truth. For the Father seeks such people to be his worshipers. The Father is after true worshipers. True worship looks different for every single person. You know, worship is not a song that you sing. It's not. Worship is a lifestyle response to a holy God. Everything we do is meant to be worship. And here's the thing, even with us connecting with God, like we all connect with God differently. The way you connect with God is different than the way I connect with God, and we're all made differently. I'm going to talk more about this point more next week, about how we all individually connect with God. And the incredible thing about that is as the people in Nehemiah, as they begin to repent and turn from their sin, it led, and Ezra and Nehemiah told the people, stop weeping. Because you understand the word of God. Because the joy of the Lord is your strength. And what I believe and what I know is as we begin to hate our sin and we turn from sin, what comes in the morning after we turn from sin is the joy of the Lord that fills our life. Do you understand that we can have the joy of the Lord when we turn from our sin? There is a better way to live, which is in Christ. We're going to talk more about that next week. But he's looking after the purity of our hearts. Amen? If the band wants to join me here on stage, I want to read this story to you. My wife shared this with me on Wednesday in a devotion that she read. It says this, in 1949, one of the greatest revivals in the history of the United Kingdom took place in the Hebrides, I don't know what city that is, in Duncan Campbell, it's in England. The preacher at the center of the revival later described how it began. Seven men and two women had decided to pray earnestly for revival. One night at a prayer meeting held in a barn, a young man took his Bible and read from Psalm 24. It's a psalm that we read this morning. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in the holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. The man shut his Bible and said, it seems to me just so much sentimental humbug to be praying as we are praying, to be waiting as we are waiting here, if we ourselves are not rightly related to God. He asked God to reveal in his heart, in his own hands, if his own hands were clean, his heart was impure. That night, God met them in a powerful way. As they waited on God, his awesome presence swept the barn. They came to understand that revival is always related to holiness. A power was let loose that shook the parish from center to circumference. Three men were lying on the straw, having fallen under the power of God. They were lifted out of the ordinary into the extraordinary. They knew that God had visited them, and neither they nor their parish could ever be the same again. 4 miles away, two sisters aged 82 and 84 had a vision from God. They saw the churches crowded and the youth in the community flocking into the churches. They had a glorious assurance that God was coming in revival power. Duncan Campbell, that pastor, was invited to come and speak to them. When he arrived in the parish church, it was packed out with hundreds waiting outside. No one could explain where they had come from. Within 10 minutes of service starting, men and women were crying out to God. They were meeting with God in all his holiness. There was such a sense of the presence of God on that island that a businessman visiting said, the moment I stepped ashore, I was suddenly conscious of the presence of God. God was meeting his people. How do you and I meet with God? How do we develop personal revival in our life? Or as David put it, Psalm 24, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who may stand in his holy place? How many of you want to desire to stand in the holy place of God? Come on, anyone in this room? If that is you this morning, would you rise to your feet? We want to stand in the holy place with God. We want to know what it's like, Lord, to be standing in your presence and to be with you. We want your manifest presence.